This video is sponsored by Surfshark. It's year 2040 and sea levels are rising due to global warming. You're the Prime Minister of the Netherlands, a country with 26% of its land below sea level. You have a budget to improve the dikes and prevent a tragedy. Your engineers conclude that the more you spend on building dikes, then the lower the risk of a deadly flood. However, they also conclude that the risk is never zero, no matter how much money you spend. You're going to have to accept a certain probability of a deadly flood. The engineers give you three options. Option A, go cheap and build a basic wall. It costs $100 million, and with this wall, you have a 20% chance of a deadly flood in the next century. It's not great, but it does the job. Option B, spend $10 billion and build a more advanced seawall. It's much better, but there's still a 5% chance of a deadly flood in the next century. Option C, spend the entire national budget of $500 billion to build the best seawall possible. You'll be saving as many lives as you can, but there's still a 1% chance of a deadly flood happening the next century. However, that also means you will not have any money left to build hospitals, schools, roads, and pretty much anything. You will have bankrupted the Netherlands. Which option do you choose? How much are you willing to spend to save lives? How much is a life worth? Even though I made up these numbers, this is a real problem the Netherlands have to deal with. In 1953, a storm in the North Sea caused a major flood in the Netherlands that killed 1,800 people. Later, the Netherlands started Delta Works, a series of construction projects to study and prevent a similar catastrophe from happening again. And to decide how much to spend on dikes, they had to decide how much they were willing to spend to save a human life. We'll be looking at how they solve this problem, how much countries are willing to spend to prevent a death, and what 500 of you, the audience, think about the ethics of putting a value on life. Now, some of my subscribers don't know this, but I'm a Portuguese currently living in the Netherlands. There are some things I've missed since I moved here. I miss the weather, I miss the food, and I also miss watching Portuguese football. This type of content is usually not available abroad. That's where Surfshark VPN, the sponsor of this video, comes in. A VPN cannot fix Dutch weather or Dutch food, but luckily it can fix the last problem. I've been using Surfshark VPN to bypass online restrictions and watch Portuguese TV content. Surfshark allows you to change your virtual location and unlock content from other countries. This also means you can unlock content from other countries on streaming services like Netflix. A VPN is also important for your privacy when you use a public Wi-Fi. Public Wi-Fi networks are often unsecured, allowing people with a bit of technical know-how to intercept your personal information such as passwords and credit card numbers. A VPN acts as a secure tunnel for your data and keeps your data safe. You can click the link in the description or scan a QR code on screen to try Surfshark for yourself, and if you use code Memeable, you'll get an extra 3 months free. You also get a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out. To many people, putting a price on life is out of question. And yet, governments have to decide how much they're willing to spend to save lives. How much should we invest in road safety? How do we decide which health treatments are affordable enough to be adopted? A common way to solve this problem is to use the value of a statistical life. In 2022, the US Department of Transportation set this value at $12.5 million. What does that mean? Imagine we have a road and we want to rebuild it to improve its safety. About 40,000 people die in car accidents every year in the US. Let's say two of those deaths happen on this road. Roads typically last about 25 years, so that means 50 people will probably die on this road if we rebuild it with the same features. An engineer comes up with a plan. Add some safety features like barriers and pedestrian crossings to half the expected number of deaths down to one per year, meaning you'll save 25 lives during the next 25 years. According to the US Department of Transportation, this improvement is worth $12.5 million for each death avoided, which adds up to $312.5 million. If adding these safety measures is more expensive than that, then the money is probably better spent elsewhere. Of course, in reality, decisions are not based only on this value, but this is a key metric. Does the value of $12.5 million per life sound unethical to you? Well, ask you guys how much you would be willing to spend to improve your own road safety. You see, the value of a statistical life does not represent the intrinsic worth of a human life. It's a value for a risk reduction, and it represents how much the US are willing to spend to reduce the risk of a road fatality. So I asked my subscribers to choose between two roads. Option 1 is the first road, which has the same death rate as an average American road. The toll price is $2.2. Option 2 is the new road, which is twice as safe but costs $4.4. Would you be willing to spend an additional $2.2 to improve your road safety? You can pause the video now if you want to participate and see the details of the two options. most people chose option 1. If you chose this option, that implies you're not willing to spend $2.2 additional to reduce your risk of death in 0.000175%, which suggests you give yourself a life valuation of less than $12.5 million, at least in the context of road safety. So take that in consideration before you're too hard on the US Department of Transportation. You might also be wondering how they got this value of $12.5 million. Typically, there are two main methods to do this. First, surveys that measure the preference stated by people, surveys like this one. And secondly, we can also analyze the preferences revealed by consumers by looking at how much they spend on products like safer cars, insurance, and bicycle helmets. Both methods depend on the wealth of the country and its cultural values, which is why you end up with differences between countries. Here you can see some of the values I found. As you would expect, richer countries like the US tend to have a higher valuation. Which brings us back to the Netherlands. In 2012, the Dutch were using a value of a statistical life of 7 million euros to plan their dikes. The way they solved their dike problem is by doing a cost-benefit analysis with a cost penalty of 7 million euros for every expected death. So if you build better dikes, you spend more money building them, but you also save more money on the cost penalties of the expected deaths. If you combine the two costs, the minimum of that line gives you the best trade-off between risk and reward and tells you how much the government should spend on the dikes. Based on this math, the government set different safety standards for each region. In 2016, the probability of a flood in Amsterdam was 0.08% per year, or an expected one flood for every 1250 years. The ethics of these problems can get even more complicated. Imagine a 19-year-old patient has a serious disease which, without treatment, will kill him within 1 year. There is a treatment that can cure the man immediately and allow him to have a life expectancy of 80 years. However, the treatment costs $1.5 million and the National Health Service has a limited budget. Do you think the treatment is worth the money? Over 80% of my audience said yes and seems to agree his life is worth at least $1.5 million. Now, what if instead we have an 80-year-old man who is in bad health and has an expected 2 years left to live? He is now diagnosed with the same disease as the first patient. Without treatment, the disease will kill him within 1 year. If he gets treatment and the disease is cured, but his other health conditions remain, meaning he will spend the last 2 years of life in a hospital with severe health complications. If the treatment costs $1.5 million, do you think it's worth it? Now the results from my audience flipped. More than 80% of my audience thinks the old man should not get the treatment. There are two big differences between these two scenarios. First, the number of additional years of life that the first patient gets with the treatment, and secondly, the quality of those years. A treatment that gives you years of life spent in poor health is not as good as a treatment that returns you to your good health. That's why in healthcare, a different concept is used. The quality-adjusted life year, also known as QALY. A value of 1 corresponds to 1 year in good health, whereas a value of 0 corresponds to death. A value somewhere in the middle corresponds to a year with health limitations. The first scenario gives you 60 years of life in good health, which corresponds to 60 QALYs. If the treatment costs $1.5 million, then that's a cost effectiveness of $25,000 per QALY. If you answer yes to this question, then you're implying a year of life in good health is worth at least that value. $25,000 is about £20,000, which is the value under which the UK considers the treatment to be cost efficient. The blue bars in this chart show the health technologies that were approved by the UK and their respective costs per QALY. In red, you have the health technologies that were rejected. As you can see, some health technologies cost more than £20,000 per QALY and were approved, so this threshold is not the only criteria used by the UK, but you can definitely see that the higher the cost per QALY, the less likely it is for a health technology to be approved. It's controversial to assign a value to someone's life, and these methods have limitations. Some people misinterpret the value of a statistical life, which is one of the reasons why politicians don't communicate it very often. During the first COVID wave, governments had to make a decision between protecting the economy or saving lives. Many countries used the hospital capacities to determine the lockdown measures, but we never really hear the value of a statistical life being mentioned. And yet, the interesting thing to me is that even if we don't use the value of a statistical life explicitly, we end up using it implicitly. If you're only willing to apply limited lockdown restrictions to protect the economy, then implicitly, you're saying it's not worth it financially to save lives beyond that point. With some reverse calculations, you could calculate the implicit value of a statistical life, which is exactly what this group of researchers did. They looked at how long governments waited to implement lockdowns during the first wave of COVID to estimate the implicit cost they were prepared to pay to protect their citizens. They estimated that the value of a statistical life in South Korea, a country which had early and strict COVID restrictions, was between $6.7 and $11.6 million, whereas in countries that took longer to apply lockdown measures, it was significantly lower. So, even if you refuse to put a price on life, your actions will do it for you. The point of this discussion is not to find how much your life is worth, but to discuss how we can find a compromise between saving lives and the limits of what society can afford. Unfortunately, we cannot prevent every death, but using a common metric like the value of a statistical life can help us make more informed decisions and makes the choice of priorities more transparent to the public. For me personally, it's also a reminder that a certain risk of death is part of life. There are risks you decide to take, like doing an extreme sport, and there are others you can't really decide on. Every time you step out of your house to do things like buying groceries, you could get run over by a car and die. There are over 4,000 pedestrian fatalities per year in the EU, meaning that if you live here, there's a 0.001% chance you'll get run over by a car every year. You could minimize that risk by never leaving your home, but instead, you accept it. Or at least, I hope you do. Thank you for watching. If you like stories told with data, consider leaving a like and subscribing to the channel. And thank you to our patrons.